those children, so.
They're adorable.
Jeremy!
I can edit this film for YouTube.
It's not a picture. Cheers! To Sam and Katie! Are you recording me? Is this a video? Hi! Am I supposed to talk? Who's up there that I can get a drink?
Mexico and Israel. It's amazing how many of you traveled to come here today. and I'm pleased for Katie and Sam that you did. I think it's impossible for me to summarize what I feel for her. I have three kids, I love all of them. They're all different. Katie was the runt of the litter. And when it came time for her to go to high school, her mother said, let her take the bus. I don't remember how it got started, I honestly don't. But every morning I would take her to high school and every day I would pick her up. And that started a chain, an ability of communication, which she and I have kept going to this day. She went to school in Colorado. We would travel across the country together. And her mother, bless her soul, would say, how can you be in the car with her all day? And I said, it's really easy. Katie entertains me. She talks all day. Except for the last time when I picked her up at Colorado College and she slept all day. I think because she'd been up all night. I'm especially appreciative for Katie's friends from high school and college that are here today. I think that the loyalty that you guys have shown her is amazing. I think that it's very nice that family is here from all over the country, both Sam's and Katie's. And I thought long and hard about how I would like to wish them for the rest of their life, and I really only have one wish, and that's that they're happy together. I figure if they're happy, everything else follows. Success, fecundity, all of those are two terms. But if they're happy together, those will come. I would also like to thank Judy and Sam's mother for the abundant nervous energy that resulted in this wonderful event that we would have. Lane and I served an important role. Lane and I served an important role, and that was to stand in the background. But most of all, Katie and Sam, I wish you happiness for the rest of your life from the bottom of my heart.
To do is propose a toast to Judy and Dennis Roadhouse, who've just been such, it's just wonderful to be in their family and to have them in our family. So, now to Sam and Katie.
As you begin your journey of married life,
I wish for you a road that is paved with beautiful, wonderful jewels, each representing the richness of life.
For example,
good friends, health, joy in each other, satisfaction with your careers, loving, supportive family. And if you find that some of these jewels are buried and difficult to unearth, please remember all of the people that are here this evening, all of whom will gladly lend you a hand to unearth and uncover each of the treasures that await you. To Sam and Katie, Mazel Tov and L'chaim.
One way to stop me without using my eyes. people in this room who love Sam, and I say this in the kindest possible way, you are a big old group of fakers.
Not because you don't really love Sam, we're sure you do, but because you didn't grow up with him, and thus, you don't know the real Sam.
So we are here today with a solemn vow to teach you about the greatness that is Sam Garfinkel. Today, right now, you get to find out the true story of Samuel Maxwell Garfinkel I. The first memory I have of my brother is hearing my mother scream from upstairs, "Oh my God, Sam, he fell in the toilet!"
When Sam was 7 years old, he was attacked by a kitten named Fievel. The next day, Sam dedicated his life to destroying every copy of the movie in American Tale. He succeeded. No one has seen the movie since 1989.
Sam's favorite movie is American Tale 2, Fievel Goes West.
Sam once won a regional pumpkin carving competition by painting his face orange and holding a ghastly facial expression for 14 hours straight.
These are all true. When he was 11 years old, Sam was offered $50 by our father if he could successfully eat an entire plum. Sam took the plum out of our father's hand, looked him dead in the eyes, and threw the plum in the trash. He walked off like an action hero walking away from an explosion in slow motion. It was awesome.
Sam turned in his homework once in sixth grade.
Selected by a program for moderately privileged white sports fans to speak in front of the British Parliament. He used the opportunity to rail against English muffins, claiming that they much more closely resembled bread than a muffin. He was awarded the Pulitzer Prize for commentary.
Sam once spent a whole day shoveling snow out of the driveways of all the people on our block in Timber Ridge. When they offered to pay him, he simply said, "The satisfaction of a job well done is payment enough for me." The next day, he reported them all for violating child labor laws.
When Rachel was born, a 5-year-old Sam asked our mother where babies come from. Our mom said, "Well, Sammy, when a man loves a woman," Sam cut her off and said, "Nah, just playing. I know where babies come from, fool."
Okay, now for the real stuff. Shmoo-man, as your one and only younger sibling, I feel that I have a pretty good perspective. I've always thought you were really cool. When you ate Cinnamon Toast Crunch, I ate Cinnamon Toast Crunch. When you ate spaghetti, I ate spaghetti. And when you ate peanut butter, I ate peanut butter. I thought you were so cool, in fact, that I even put up with your nonsense, such as accepting broccoli as a nickname for an absurd 12 years. Of course, you eloquently explained that this nickname was based off of my Hebrew name Rachel, which led to Rachel, which led to broccoli. But I think you just made the connection at a young age that you had a similar relationship with your younger sister and your favorite vegetable. Of course, one of my favorite childhood memories depicting our relationship is the water gun debacle of 1997. I can only assume it started innocently enough with mom taking you to a toy store to buy me a present for my 6th birthday. The weather was already warm, so you had the great idea of getting me a water gun. But of course, you needed a water gun too, as well, in order to be able to, you know, have a water gun fight. So mom bought you one. But mom failed to notice the ridiculous difference between the two water guns. Mine being a pretty standard children's water gun that held approximately 0.5 liter of water, and yours being military grade and an accessory to it attached to the hose. Which you used to spray me while I cried in our front yard. When we got older, I mostly stuck to the same routine of thinking you had done things right. I joined BBYO, I attended a Big Ten school, and even in recent years, I have copied one of your favorite hobbies. I started caring about sports. Granted, it's only one team, and granted, I don't know much about them at all. Our relationship changed when I went off to college. You started liking me more because, as I just said, I went to football games and generally cared about the fate of a sports team. But you also began to fill the void of not having Dad around. You called me to see how I was doing, and you tried to keep me alive by giving me advice that always had the general gist of have fun, don't die. Sam, I love you so incredibly much, and I've always looked up to you. You're my older brother and one of my closest friends. Katie, I'm so grateful that we've had the opportunity to become close in the past year, and as I've said numerous times, I'm so excited to finally have a sister. I wish you two nothing but happiness and cannot wait to see what wonderful things the future holds. Mazel tov.
There's more. Webster's Dictionary defines a wedding as the process of removing weeds from one's garden. And that's what Sam and Katie are doing today. Removing the weeds from the yard that is their life and planting a giant tree that will represent their marriage. Trees are a lot like marriage when you think about them. It's pretty obvious, so I won't waste your time by drawing the analogy for you. Katie, I'll start with you. You're very lucky that Sam could not marry Joakim Noah. You are also welcome into our family with open arms. I know you are taking the name Garfinkel, and I'd like to tell you exactly what that means. According to Ancestry.com, Garfinkel is an ornamental name or nickname from the Yiddish Gorfunkel. Garfinkel has two meanings. It denotes either a red precious or semi-precious stone, such as a garnet or ruby, in which case it is an ornamental name, or it denotes a large inflamed growth on the skin like a large boil, in which case it is restricted. So let's say it's the former. Katie, you are an amazing young woman. I've really enjoyed getting to know you. You are smart and curious and quick to laughter and even quicker to support my brother when I argue against him. I can't tell you how much I respect you for that. I look forward to arguing against both of you at many Thanksgivings in the future. Samuel. Male intimacy can be a funny thing. At the end of a phone conversation with my mother, we say I love you to each other before hanging up. Same with my sister. At the end of the call, love you, bye. But when Sam and I talk on the phone, we end our call with later, homie, which makes very little sense because I do not know what homie means. I just say it because Marge calls Homer homie sometimes on The Simpsons. Or Sam will say, catch you later, bro, which I suppose does make sense because we are literally bros. But Sam, even though we never say it on the phone in private, I'd like to say it in front of all these people here today. I love you. And I'd like to share with everyone here today why I love you so goddamn much. It's funny that you say catch you later at the end of phone calls, because all I can think of when you say that is the time you were at a White Sox game when you were 8 or 9 years old. Lance Johnson hit a foul ball sky high, and as it fell toward our family, Dad grabbed a 3-year-old Rachel and shielded her with his body. A moment later, the ball funked you in the stomach. You didn't even cry. I remember being about 13 years old and thinking, my little brother doesn't cry when he gets hit by a baseball? Shit! I cry when Mom doesn't let me have cake. It was the first time I can remember looking up to you. And I'll be honest, it was the only time for a long time. But then, a few years ago, somewhere along the line, you passed me up. You became the most responsible person I know, the hardest working person I know, and the most dedicated person I know. When our father died, I lost a role model. I, of course, still have my mother, and let's face it, when it comes to moms, Rachel, Sam, and I won the lottery, but I missed having a man I could look up to and emulate. Dad's work ethic, his determination to see his children succeed, his passion for family and love for the people around him, it's all I see when I look at you now. I said somewhere along the line you passed me up, and what I meant, if I was at all unclear, is that you became the man Dad wanted to be before I did. I'm still working on getting there, and I know you have room to grow as well, but you have blossomed into the role model I lost when Dad passed away. You may be my little brother, but I look up to you, sir. There's an old family video of Sam following me around as I play with various toys. Sam was about 2 or 3 years old, I was 6 or 7. I'd play with a toy for a minute and throw it down and run to another toy. Every single time I threw a toy on the ground, Sam picked it up and tried to imitate me using it. Mom always used to tell me back then that you loved me, but I never saw it. I just thought you were a plain little miniature-sized jerk trying to impede on my fun. However, when watching that video as an adult, I feel not only your love for me, but also a responsibility to live the right way to set an example for you. But, as I have said twice already, somewhere along the line, you passed me up. Now I want to copy you, Sam, and live up to your example. You have found yourself a wonderful wife, a stable job, and the happiness that a secure household can bring. You may be my little brother, but I measure myself by you. So please join me in congratulating Mr. and Mrs. Sarah Guthrie.
But also give each other room to still be themselves. They love each other unconditionally. I remember one time last winter when Katie and I were at my parents' house for dinner. Katie was supposed to go meet Sam to go out with some friends, but with the snow and the infamous polar vortex, she just wasn't really into it. Shocking, Katie didn't want to go out. So I told Katie, just tell Sam you don't want to go. Her reply was, yeah, but if I tell Sam I don't want to go, he's not going to go. And he really wants to go. And that, to me, illustrated how perfect they were for each other. Sam would have dropped everything and hung out with Katie at home, but Katie recognized that Sam really wanted to do it, so was willing, even though she didn't want to go. I think this is a great example of the ways in which Katie and Sam were good for each other. As I mentioned, they improve each other, they make each other better, but also support and love each other. And the most impressive thing to me that's been more apparent over this weekend than ever before is that they just get each other. So let's raise our glass to Katie and Sam, my grown-up little sister, and her perfect match. Mazel tov. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Please enjoy the remainder of your dinner.
What?
Special huge thanks to Judy and Dennis. Everything you've done over the past year plus has just been overwhelming. And we couldn't even begin to do things with you. Mom, you as well, obviously. Thank you for everything. Even my call this morning in a panic about, do I need to bring something here? I still didn't know, and you obviously knew right away, just like you always know where my keys are. It's amazing to see all of you in this place. And Katie's brother, Derek, actually gave us some great advice yesterday, which was to just take a step back and really just look at everyone here, because it really is the only time we'll ever see everyone here. And so we just wanted to say how happy we are for each and every one of you. And we apologize if we have not said hi to you directly yet. There's a lot of people, but please come up to us and say hi and just welcome, enjoy yourself, and yeah, let's let the dancing start so we can have some fun, right?
For me, but Only time.